Welcome back to another episode of The Road Shows Me. And today, something a little bit different. It is Christmas Eve after all. As you can see, I'm wearing my favorite all-time Christmas sweater. Yes, that's right. It is a skiing kangaroo and it says Australia on the sleeve. If you can't wear this on Christmas Eve, when are you gonna wear it? But anyway, lots of people have been asking me, who am I? Who is Dan? Why do I get to have this life of driving around the world? How did I even end up living in Canada, obviously being from Australia in the first place? So today I'm gonna go back in time and I'll give you a big introduction into who I am and how I got started in all of this. But before I do that, there's a couple of little housekeeping things to talk about. First of all, my new book is finally finished and it's for sale. So The Road Shows Me Volume 2, this is my book all about my Africa expedition. So 54,000 miles through 35 countries all the way around Africa. This is a huge book. It's 385 pages, about 125,000 words. It has 35 photographs spread throughout the interior. And this is available for sale now. You can buy the paperback edition on Amazon. You can buy an electronic copy on Amazon that you can read on your Kindle or your phone or your laptop or whatever. And you can also get the electronic copy on Apple Books. And so I'll put links to all of that down in the description. But before we get into that, which I'll cover next time, I'd like to go back in time and talk about my first adventure. And I wrote a book about that as well. This one is called The Road Chose Me Volume 1. So this book starts out from the very beginning of who I am and how I got into all of this. And so to cover what I'm talking about, I'm gonna read you a few excerpts from the early stages of this book so you can get more of an idea of what inspired me and how I came up with this whole idea in the first place. And as always, I really wanna emphasize, I'm just a normal guy. When I set out, I had no sponsors. I didn't work for National Geographic. The little vehicle I drove cost $5,000. I actually had never even heard of the word overlanding, and I didn't bump into anyone else doing it until I got down to the border of Mexico and Belize. So it was a long time coming before I even knew what overlanding was and that there was this big community of people doing it. And that's what I want you to remember. I'm an ordinary guy. I didn't have a ton of money. I'm not rich. I don't have a trust fund. And if I made this expedition happen, then you can make this expedition happen too. And as I read through the book here, I'm gonna throw up photos from the trip and from my early life to give you a sense of what it actually looked like. Make no mistake about it, this was the most epic thing I've ever done in my life. And if you're thinking about doing the same, I highly encourage you to go for it. So it is Christmas Eve, grab a drink, get warm by your fire, and have a listen as I read through some of the early stages of The Road Chose Me, Volume 1. Awakening, Lake Tahoe, California, winter 2004-2005. In a vague kind of way, I knew how my life would go from the age of about 15. When I finished school, I would get a job and work hard for 30 or 40 years until retirement. Probably I would have a wife and kids, a dog and a cat. If I worked really hard, maybe even a sports car. That was the future I saw in front of me. It seemed, at the time, not bad. Growing up in a farming town in rural Australia, my family lived a middle-class life. Mum and Dad were both teachers, and our family friends were either white-collar office types or hard-working, salt-of-the-earth farmers. By the end of my fifth and final year of engineering, I was exhausted, utterly fed up with 18 straight years of schooling. My university held a job fair where all the big employers like IBM and Oracle were scouting for talent. Too burned out to do any schmoozing, I wandered around in a daze until I saw a huge sign, snowboarding in the USA. I was hooked, and as you might imagine, his was the only application I filled in that day. 3 long months later, I skipped my own graduation and fly to Lake Tahoe in California. My winter at Kirkwood continues for 5 months, always living a life I had never dreamed possible. Every day is a grand new adventure, and I love every second. When the snow finally melts after a record-setting season, Brandon and I hit the road in sunshine, surfing the California coast for a month. It's a fitting end to 6 months of fun in the USA. I make the long trek back to Australia and can't stop thinking about the crew I met at Kirkwood. None of them has much money, but they're all happier than anyone I've ever met before. How do they do that? I have to know. Growing up in small town Australia, I thought going to work for life was the only path to happiness. I thought if I worked hard and earned a good wage, I would be guaranteed a happy life. Not only did the Kirkwood crew teach me a whole new way of being happy without lots of money, they also taught me a whole new level of happiness I had no idea existed. Somehow, in all the years of school, lessons and studying, I had missed the classes about having fun. I missed the lessons about living right now. And I missed all the notes about how to really be alive. Luckily, these guys came along at just the right time in my life and gave me the education I had missed. I'll spend the rest of my life living the lessons I learned that winter in California. Setting out, Calgary, Alberta, June 2009. After almost a year back in Australia, I returned to North America to work at kids' summer camps and ski resorts across the USA and Canada. At one resort, I stumble across a copy of Long Way Round, Ewan McGregor and Charlie Borman's tale of their motorbike ride around the world from London to New York City. Soon I'm completely engrossed and can't stop reading for 2 days and nights. It's one of the best books I've ever read. Ewan and Charlie journey through countries I've never dreamed possible, trying new food and learning new languages. For months on end, they see new places, meet new characters, and set up their tents wherever they can find a quiet place. To me, this is real adventure. I soon realize, however, this is not an achievable adventure for an ordinary guy like me. Ewan is an international superstar, and their journey cost millions of dollars and required sponsorships, support vehicles, border helpers, and years of planning and logistics. The list of hurdles is endless. When I finish reading, I'm left with one powerful thought. Too bad I can never do something like that. Completely out of money and backed into a corner, I suck it up and get an engineering job in Calgary. It's great to rent a room, have stable friends, go to the gym, and cook healthy food after years of transient living. My brother Mike soon follows me to Canada, and in the winter, I often make weekend visits to the Rockies so we can snowboard together. During one visit, Mike hands me a book that forever changes my life. In Jupiter's Travels, Ted Simon details his 4-year motorbike adventure around the world. From London to Cape Town through Africa, Rio de Janeiro to Vancouver in the Americas, around Australia, and finally from Southeast Asia back to London through the heart of Central Asia, Ted really does ride right around the world. While similar to Ewan and Charlie's book, the life-changing part for me is the realization that Ted was a completely average guy who set out to live a dream. Ted had never ridden a motorbike and didn't even have a license. He had a tiny savings account, no sponsors, and zero experience with an adventure so big. Ted was an average guy. One day, he simply made the decision to do something unbelievably big. The more I think about it, the more I realize I'm an average guy dreaming of doing something unbelievably big. I can't stop thinking how similar to Ted I am. It hits me like a ton of bricks. The only thing stopping me is deciding to go. With my days occupied at work and my savings account slowly creeping up, I start daydreaming about where I want to go. Calgary is a fine place to live, though I sense I don't fit in. Everyone around me is buying expensive cars and new clothes while I focus on the bottom line of my savings account. I walk to work and go to the bar wearing my old snowboarding jacket patched with duct tape. As the months roll by, my dreams slowly develop into a concrete plan. At Kirkwood, Jeff filled my head with stories of Alaskan adventure, awakening the fascination I felt since reading Jack London's epic White Fang and The Call of the Wild as a young boy. Talking about my vague idea of quitting my job and driving north to Alaska for the summer, a friend suggests an extension. After Alaska, I should continue south to Mexico, he says. The beaches are amazing, tacos are cheap and delicious, and it's not difficult to drive your own car. I have previously been to Tijuana from San Diego and absolutely loved it, so Mexico sounds like a great idea. In the midst of a brutal Calgary winter, a few months on the beach would be paradise on earth. When I buy a map of Mexico, all of Central America stretches to the south. After staring at the map for an hour, I rush out to buy another map, South America. After another hour of staring, I can't wipe the smile off my face as I connect the dots and start dreaming really, really big. For 7 months, my room is plastered with maps of North, Central, and South America and huge sheets of paper where I write lists of everything I need to organize, bring, and plan to make the journey a reality. I have a list of Jeep work, a list of medical supplies to bring, a list of spare parts and tools I need, and at one point, even a list of lists somehow grows. Every morning I wake staring at the maps, and every night I go to sleep with them in my dreams. I have a huge amount of work to do and stuff to organize, so I aim to check one item off each day. With this approach, the planning and preparation does not feel overwhelming, and the whole journey starts off feeling achievable. After years of camping and hiking in the Rockies with a minimum of equipment, I'm confident the gear I already own will see me through. My two-man tent and small alcohol stove are well loved and both still function perfectly. Although I want to, I know deep down I don't need to buy anything new or fancy like a rooftop tent, a fridge, or a winch for the Jeep. I plan to hit the road with a minimum of savings, which means the choice comes down to working longer to pay for new gear and upgrades on the Jeep, or to hit the road as soon as possible with what I already have. I choose to hit the road sooner, of course. My best guess puts the total distance at 30,000 miles, including the many detours I know I'll make, which I think will take roughly a year. Both of those are ballpark estimates, and as long as I can make my savings of about $10,000 stretch, taking more time is great. After all, this is not a vacation from my life. This is my life. Researching the crossing from Panama to Colombia indicates that it could turn into a logistical headache, and I find it comforting to view Panama as a possible endpoint. If I really dislike what I'm doing, or it's too difficult, or I feel unsafe, I can sell the Jeep in Panama and do something else with my life. I find it easier not to look at the immense task as a whole, instead only to look a few days or weeks ahead. When people tell me about Peru, I immediately zone out and try not to listen. I don't want to get overwhelmed thinking about driving my Jeep to Peru. I mean, that's crazy. I can't do that. I just plan to drive north to Alaska and then south into Mexico. After that, I'll see how I feel. The months fly by, and even after counting down the last 100 days, I'm shocked when it's time to give notice at work and move out. Selling and giving away all my stuff feels great, and I do that repeatedly until everything I own fits comfortably in my little Jeep. I planned and dreamed and planned for so long, leaving Calgary turns out to be anticlimactic. Of course, thinking about going is much harder than actually doing it. After a small goodbye party with a few friends, I get up one morning, get in the Jeep, and I start driving north. And just like that, a 40,000 mile road trip is underway. So I hope that's given you a little taste for my writing and where I came from and how I got into this life of overlanding. The book goes on from there, obviously, to explain the whole expedition from Alaska to Argentina. And so it's got a whole bunch of stories about the adventures that I had, the people I met, some details on the Jeep, funny stories with bribery, the border crossings. People have been asking lately, do I get lonely on the road? Yes, I do. There's a whole chapter about that in this book, and so on and so forth, all the way down to Tierra del Fuego in Argentina. And so this is called The Road Chose Me Volume 1, and it is also available in paperback edition on Amazon or digital copy on Amazon and Apple Books. And I'll put links to all of that down in the description as well. So if you're interested to get to know where I came from and you've dreamed of doing a similar expedition, the goal of this book was to show everyone out there that an ordinary guy like me really can make a trip like this happen. It does take hard work, it is a lot of effort, and it also is the most rewarding thing I've ever done in my whole life. So that's The Road Chose Me Volume 1. The Road Chose Me Volume 2 is also now available, and I'll go into more details in the next video. And a quick little aside too, my Patreon supporters are getting postcards for Christmas. That's just one of the many perks you get if you become a supporter of my channel. Help me bring these videos to life. So thanks very much to everyone on Patreon. And to everyone out there, I wish you guys a Merry Christmas. It's been a really tough 2020, and I actually had dreamed of going to spend Christmas with my family, but that can't happen. Quarantine is what it is, and I can't fly anywhere. So I'm here without family, but you know, I'm gonna jump on video chat. I'm gonna try to involve my family and my friends here in town. So I hope you guys can do the same as well. Even though we've had a rough year, hopefully we could have a good Christmas. We can spend time with our families, even if it's online, and we can all look forward to 2021. Fingers crossed for new adventures and the world getting back to some kind of normal. So as always, thanks so much for watching. Thanks for helping make The Road Shows Me a success that it has become in 2020. And as always, stay safe out there.